All right, welcome back to day 5 of NaNoWriMo. We're still writing our story, Washed Up, a pirate adventure. And we are looking at possibly hitting the inciting incident today, I hope. It's about 10 o'clock at night on, again, November 5th. And so I don't clearly have a lot of time before midnight to get much done, but I am setting my goal for 1,500 words. Which I think I can do. Just a quick note, in my pre-session, you can probably see here, I do think I'm on track to hitting the inciting incident tonight. My goal is to hit it within, again, 1,500 words, or about the 9,000 word mark. If you look here by the math, I've got it set up for the 12.5% setting. So this is just a kind of a round estimate, but I'm pretty sure we're going to get there, because what we've already done, in case you're a late arrival to the series, is we've established our hero Jack Cowgren as he's an actor who's not really that great at acting. I mean, I'm probably gonna have to change some of that, because he's been doing it since he's 15 and he's 23 now, so he should probably be at least kind of good. So I do think I should probably need to make some changes, you know, once I do the editing and rewriting and all of that, to make him a little more competent at his job as an actor. It may be that just people are not very receptive to him, and that can be another thing entirely. But we are if you caught yesterday's episode, what we are implying is that he currently is, he's basically broke. He just spent all of his money getting a hotel or a room at the inn, I guess we got to call it by what it's called. And then he's going to bed with water dripping on his face. So not exactly a good situation for him. He's going to wake up grumpy, groggy, and not very good at what he's doing. So there will probably be some changes that I'll make in the rewrites, so he's not quite so pathetic. This is all first draft stuff that we're doing, and you know how first drafts go. If you're a writer at all, you know that your first draft's the worst draft. And you know, if you're watching this, thanks, because you know this is not going to be indicative of the final product, I can assure you of that. But there are things that we want to figure out as we go, and then we do want to make some changes accordingly. So anyway, point being is that today I am at a point where we're going to go into the stage play that they're there to perform. And the idea isn't going to go very well. So we'll see how we end up. But my goal is to get them to have such a bad performance that they not only are not invited back to perform the next night, but that the people at Carousel want them to leave. And so that's going to be interesting, I think. Again, in the editing, I might make some changes later, but we'll see how that goes. So anyway, let's just see what happens. That's kind of the name of the game. I've got everything set up already. My word count, again, is already set for 1,500, so that's what we're going to do. So you can, again, if you're late to the party, this little bar will fill up as I get closer to the goal. So anyway, let's get started. So remember, he's, just to refresh your memory from day 4, he is currently in bed, and he is getting water on his face. So, Jack Halgren, or we don't need to say his name over and over, Jack, could not sleep that night as much as he wanted to, and as much as he tried. As an actor, he often, he had often, I remember those stupid perfect tenses, as an actor he had often found himself in situations that required him to, let's see, as an actor he had often found some situations, let's do this, in difficult situations that required him to perform above and beyond his usual means. Sometimes he would be asked to, let's see, do I want to, for example, sometimes he would be asked to I don't want to do anything stupid here. I want something that's kind of funny but not ridiculous. So Okay, so sometimes he'd be asked to do I want to perform twice? You know what? Again, vocabulary can be fixed in another draft. Sometimes he would be asked to perform a high kick in a scene where he had to pretend... I don't know. Pork. Don't love that. Sometimes he'd be asked to perform... Alright, let's do a sword fight. I keep thinking it should be something like that. Sometimes he'd be asked to perform a sword fight using wooden swords in full body contact, which would end with him receiving a bruise to the chest over the course of several nights. He would go to bed in pain, where the bruising would be so bad. The bruising would be so bad that he would go to bed in pain. Typically, he would get every, they wouldn't get every other night. No, that won't work. I was going to say, maybe they get like every third day off, but that's, yeah, I think in real life actors, I don't think they get any days off, so I don't know why they would then either, especially since standards are much harsher in the 1700s. Of course, over the course of several nights, the bruising would be so bad that he would go to bed in pain, but he would get up the next day, clench his teeth in an effort to focus on something other than the pain, guzzle a bit of wine to numb the pain, and carry on with the next showing, which would, of course, lead to more pain. Within a week, the pain would be so intense that he would no longer feel it, and he would get to sleep just fine. Over several months of such pain, he would learn how to numb all of his senses. Let's see, he would learn how to ignore the bruising. See, over several months of incurring such pain, he would learn how to ignore the, bruising and carry on as if he had no injury at all. Given enough abuse, and his body would develop a callus to the pain. See. And thanks to this callousness, he no longer worried about losing sleep from the pain. But what he had to deal with tonight was not pain. It was water to the face which was anything but painful, or see, which was not painful, but bloody annoying. And the one thing he had never mastered was the art of ignoring irritation. Let's see. This was why he did not own a dog. The last thing he wanted was to awake back in the middle of the night to the slobbery tongue of a dog in his face. So, trying to get to sleep was just not in the cards. When the morning arrived, Jack rolled out of bed and hit the floor, stomach first. He felt the wind rush right out of him, but at least he was no longer getting dripped upon. Now, what I probably could do at some point in the rewrite is I could probably have him try to fix the bed. In fact, maybe I will just do that now real quick. See. He did attempt to move the bed when he couldn't stand the taste of acidic water entering the corner of his lips. I don't know if it's acidic or probably some other. Well, I'll get a better idea of what the water is dripping from. For now, we'll just say acidic. It's probably rust. I don't even know if it's rusty. I'll figure it out. He did attempt to move the bed when he couldn't stand the taste of acidic water in the corner of his lips, but he was so tired that, or actually no, but the bed was, is it, does he have a bed or a cot? I don't know, let's see, but the bed was bolted to the floor, and the mattress, which I assume they have, was secured to the canvas with twine or rope, and with triple knotted twine. If you guys are out there can think of something better, let me know. I don't know anything about 18th century beds, and I'm sure they're not actually made this way, but, you know, plot. So what can you do? So he did attempt to move the bed when he couldn't stand the taste of sea water under the corner of his lips, but the bed was pulled to the floor, and the mattress was secured to the canvas, triple knot of twine, to sleep anywhere but under the drip would only be possible if he had slept on the floor, which hadn't been swept since the last visitor slept here. Okay. He would just have to take it. So yeah, I'll probably have to make some adjustments here, but anyway, there you go. Alright, so when the morning arrived, Jack rolled out of bed and hit the floor stomach first. He felt the wind rush right out of him, but at least he was no longer getting dripped upon. Mm-hmm. see, he found his clothing bundled in the sack he had brought in with him. Again, we have never really addressed that before, but maybe we will at some point. Fished out his trousers. Pulled on his vest and secured the drawstring to tighten his... fished out his tripod, pulled on his vest, and slipped on his pants, or slipped on his... How about this? We'll pull on his... pulled on his vest. Fished out his trousers. Put them on and secured the drawstring. And pulled on his vest. To tighten him around his waist, and pulled on his vest, once he checked the mirror for his hair, which was easy to comb because it was wet, he slipped on his boots and shuffled off into the hallway where he met the rest of his troop. All of whom were equally dressed and equally tired, but perhaps but a little drier than he was. After getting breakfast at the marketplace, each of them headed off to the open stage down by the northern plantation. Down by the harbor. Because I think we're going to be near the traders. Getting breakfast at the marketplace, each of them headed off down by the harbor where they set up their props and rehearsed their lines. They were performing a shortened version of Homer's The Odyssey, but with song and political commentary against the British. It had actually nothing to do with Homer's The Odyssey, but they were calling their play Homer's The Odyssey to hide the fact that they We're actually just lampooning British government. I may shorten that line to just that statement there. They were calling, they play Homer's Odyssey to hide the fact that they were actually just lampooning the British government. The truth was that the entire play took place in England. Let's see, in the theater district in the mid-18th century. But their version also had a song. Let's see. I'm trying to think here of what do they have? Do they even have, I don't think they have instruments on their team. Alright, you know what? This is driving me crazy. Let me see. And crewing. How is this not? Is this not the right? Incurring. Burp. Of course. Okay. All right, we'll fix that. So, but their version also had a song. Their costumes were vague for now. They had not brought any over from the colonies where they had last performed with an actual dress rehearsal? No, with an actual costumes were vague for now. They had not brought any over from the colonies where they had last performed with actual props and costume. Let's see. And period. I'll just call it costumes. It's fine. Let's see. The costumes were vague for now. They had not brought any over from the colonies where they had last performed with actual props. Period costumes. They had worried that they would leave important items behind. No, that's not the problem. They had wanted to bring their entire stage. I just had the word in my head. They had wanted to bring their entire stage production on the boat to the Caribbean with them, but their, what's it called, production manager? Oh, it doesn't matter. Production manager had talked them out of it, saying that they would not have the funds to replace any lost item should the ship sink or they get run out of town. They were told that if they were worth their acting salt, then they could perform a complete clay without any props or appropriate costumes or set designs. And even if they couldn't, it wouldn't matter because the Caribbean was full of unsophisticated traders who had no sense of culture or enjoyment. In other words, they were down here to see if it was even possible to get some culture down this far south. Maybe they were sent down here. I feel like this is the wrong motivation. I'm probably going to change all of this, to be honest. I don't think any of this works, but we're just, again, getting word count right now. I don't know what else they would do, though. So, because they're in the Caribbean, because, I mean, there's a good reason for it. They are trying to bring their play to people who wouldn't normally see it. I wonder if they're on the run, maybe? I don't know. It's kind of a weird notion. But they are trying to get down to Brazil at some point. I think we'd have worked that part out. But why wouldn't they have their clothing? I don't know. I'm not a big fan of how any of this goes right now. But we could. I do like the idea of them not having their props or not having the stuff that they need in order to do this right. So I'm not totally against the concept of them coming down here without. But the thing is, they had gone to Havana with something. So maybe they left it all in Havana. Maybe that's what it is. I think I'm going to set an alternate here. This is going to probably mess up our word count a little bit. But I'm going to do just a quick dirty story note. The happy... What do they call play bodies are in Curacao as a testing ground for happy players in the Curacao. Let's see, two tests to test the cultural response to their plays. I want it established that they have come without props, costumes, or set pieces. The question is why the current setup is that their production manager back in the colonies has no respect for the islanders or South Americans that they plan to perform for, but that would contradict the idea that they had a successful show in Havana. Therefore, I think the real story is that they left all of their stuff in Havana. Maybe because it was confiscated by the local government. that's probably more likely what happened. Okay, so that's what I'm thinking. For now, we're going to leave it like this, but I'm pretty sure I'm going to change it to Havana has it. We wanted to try, or actually, you know what we could do too, just to get the extra word count. Let's see. The costumes were rigged for now. They had not brought any over from the colony. No, never mind. It's already there. Okay, so it's going to be Havana later. I'll fix it. For now, I just want to keep going. Alright, so in other words, blah, blah, blah. To adequately. Let's see, no. Costumes were vague for now. They had not brought any over from the colonies where they had last performed with actual props and period costumes. They had wanted to bring their entire stage production on the boat to the Caribbean with them, but the production manager had talked them out of it, saying that they had the funds to replace any lost items should the ship sink or they get run out of town. They were told that if they were worth their acting salt, then they could perform a complete play without any props or appropriate costumes or set designs, and even if they couldn't, it mattered because the Caribbean was full of unspeakable traders and no sense of cultural enjoyment. In other words, they were sent down here to see if it was impossible to get some culture down this far south. Maybe they had almost not. They had nearly. They had nearly failed. No. Anyway, we'll fix it in post. All right. To practice a play without props or any other necessary item was certainly a challenge for each of them. Even though they were decent actors with years of experience behind them, they had not figured out how to make the most of a show by just making the whole thing up, even if the entire premise of their play was to make up the story on the spot. Okay, even if but see, by just miming the whole thing, even the entire premise of their play was to make up the story and its actions on the spot. To practice play without props or any other necessary item was certainly a challenge for each of them. Even though they were decent actors with years of experience behind them, they had not figured out how to make the most of the show. But just miming the whole thing, even if the entire premise of their play was to make up the story and its actions on the spot. To pretend they were sitting in a chair, for example, without an actual chair, seemed like an exercise in madness, and perhaps it was, but that was the consequence of sailing without the proper gear, or sailing across the sea without the proper gear. At some point, their main job was just to prove that they weren't phonies. Jack was no phony, and if anyone you could fake sitting on invisible scenery. It was Jack. It was he. See, Jack wasn't funny, even if anyone could fix sitting on invisible scenery. That was he. That was certainly his goal to prove to his mates, the audience, and himself. Now, whether he actually could fake sitting on invisible furniture, he would find out in the rehearsal. Fortunately, even if it turned out that he could do no such thing, he had about 8 hours to figure it out before the stage would open to the public. Now, I'm assuming they actually had practices, and I'm assuming that people didn't just show up and, you know, do what they just watched them perform without them really being ready for it. Again, assuming, don't know. Let's see. The first hour of practice was exactly as each of them feared. However, Ernest was certainly at the top of his game, playing the version of Ulysses who barked orders and did nothing but stand there and watch his underlings do all the work. Let's see, what's her name? Blah, blah, blah. The heck's the woman's name? Regina. Regina was also equally sophisticated in her role as Cersei. Is it Cersei or who has the picks? Is it Cersei or Calypso? Just gonna put in a little bracket for Calypso. Has the pigs. So I would normally go online and look this stuff up, but now while I'm recording, that's just a waste of time, so I'll check for another time. Regina was also equally sophisticated in her role as Cersei or Calypso as the pigs. Let's see, swaying her hips in that seductive way that gets men interested in performance art. Though she had a bit of trouble remembering her lines. Let's see. Maybelline, and by the way, her name is Maybelline now. Maybelline stood primarily in the background. coming forth only when Regina, as Cersei called upon her to fetch a jug, fetch a pretend jug of water, or pick a pretend apple off of a pretend tree. But she was excellent at stepping forward when called upon. The other male troop members were almost as impressive as Ulysses' fleetmen, whatever. So the other male troop members were almost equally as impressive as Ulysses' fleetmen, pretending to row on shore and pretending to take a nap by the sea, which was not too far from reality, as the stage was beside the harbor. Jack, who had just the night before offended Ernest, the troop leader, played the role that Ernest had promised he would play. He played a sheep. Pig. I think I'm gonna switch that up in the other one later. Okay. All right. So we're 11:44, 300 more words, and we'll hit our goal, which is good. So I think we're running our clock down a bit here. I'm probably gonna actually do this inciting event tomorrow, because I think I'm gonna be wrapping this part up here shortly. Jack, who had just the night before, if an Ernest, the troop leader, played the role of Ernest, he played the pig. His job was to crawl around on all fours and oink at the other actors whenever his part came up. They practiced their roles until 4 in the afternoon, when it was time to call the locals to the stage to gather around the stage. And see, they practiced the roles until 4 in the afternoon, when it was time to call the locals over to gather on the stage. Following British theater etiquette, they allowed the highest paying guests to sit on the stage. Everyone else had to pick a row according to what they were willing to offer. Every guest put his money in a bucket that Ernest had taken from a merchant when he wasn't looking. They took it on faith that the people paid what they said they had paid, which could have been anything, including a guilder, a cent, or even a piece of bread. No one was actually watching what went into the bucket, as the stage manager did not take the trip south with them. It would have been nice. However, because the people of Havana had collectively given them 33, what was that, Spanish, doubloons, which split between the eight of them, was barely enough to make the trip to Curacao. Most of them were simply living off of the money they had brought with them from the colonies. And if this system continued as it did, it was possible that none of them would have any money to get on the next boat, so they really needed to make this one count. Free hats to the highest tippers? I don't know. Ernest shouted as he shook the bucket at the guest. Hats to be collected at the ugly place in after the show. Jack shook his head. He couldn't believe Ernest was using this gimmick again. It didn't work out so well in Havana when the people figured out that they had just one hat, and that hat came off the head of the lowest. No, that's not freaking fun. Had just one hat. Okay. Now they didn't even have that one hat, and they weren't sure where to get one on the island that they wouldn't have to buy first. They weren't well known enough to get any charity from the locals. When Jack whispered this in Ernest's ear, Ernest changed the prize to a free night with Maybelline. Maybelline, of course, objected, so Ernest had to settle for giving the highest paying guest a free foot rub and a scalp massage, courtesy of the gentleman who would be playing a pig. Jack frowned at this trade off. Okay. Okay, we hit our goal. I think, should we go one more? If I go 100 more, then we're going to stay on target for... But I don't know. I kind of want... I feel like I want the play... I want to actually spend time making this play suck. So I think we're going to call it for tonight. I think we'll do... Yeah, I think we'll come back tomorrow and actually see what happens at the play. So I think we're going to... We made our goal. That's what I care about. So, yeah, I think that's it. So let me go ahead and put that in here for tonight. So we made it to 1.5. Was it? What did I say it was? 1.529. All right, 1.529. Word. Ugh. What? 29 words. And then our total is now at 8765. So we're getting really close to an appropriate inciting incident location, because if it hit 9,000, that's going to mean I'm on course for 72,000 word right here. That's like you said. So I'm probably going to aim for 80, so I can actually go up to 10,000 without worrying too much about being off target. So I think we're about there. So we're going to do 8 there you go. 765 words. All right. So anyway, I think that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Come back tomorrow. We'll do another one. It's going to be another late one for me, because I think I'm busy until probably pretty close to midnight. So I don't think tomorrow is going to be a high word count, and I think I'm really going to just make it about the play. And then that's going to be where we'll actually start seeing some of the action is going to kick in. So if you guys stick around, I'm still going to try to record a few more of these. I still don't know. I'm actually new all the way to day 30 on film. It's all about the work or the view count. And if I see a drop off, I mean, that's going to be my cue to stop, because it's a little bit involving, not just the recording, but the processing and all that too. But I will keep going as long as I think that it's worth it. So I do think tomorrow will be worth it, so I should have a day 6 video for you. So do please come back. Anyway, thanks. Bye.